Frank Manning, and I'm in Mr. Yarborough's second period history class. Today, we'll be talking about land expansion west of the Mississippi River.
The pioneer spirit has moved on. In this colossal migration to Oregon and California, America will finally define its character. It's the American dream. Then, as now, the people want an already good life to get better.
Our teacher, Ms. Yarborough, assigned us four essential questions that we will be answering in this video.
We sat down with Mr. Craig Schmidt, a history teacher in the high school department, about the two essential questions assigned by our history teacher.
So, how has territorial expansion been justified, or like in other words, how can Americans defend land expansion?
I think people try to defend it two ways. I think on the earliest times, you defend it on religious grounds. So God gave us this land and we have the right to take this. And this goes back, it's as old as the Bible, but everybody goes to sort of some type of religious justification. Then when you have the Enlightenment and science, and you begin to see in European and American culture that religion begins to step back and science becomes the justification. You have Darwin, social Darwinism, and then people begin to say, okay, we have a right to take over these people because we are superior in a scientific sense or a racist sense. So it's a lot of racism involved in this. It's not just it's not just an American phenomenon, because at the same time that the Americans are, stealing the land of the Sioux Indians or the Cherokee or whatever, Europeans are also trying to take over Africa, they're trying to take over India, all over the world. So, and in all of these cases, the justification issue is sort of important, because nobody, you don't wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to be bad today. Your parents will smack you down, and say, no, you don't. So nobody gets up in the morning and says, they're going to be bad. So they've got to come up with a rationale to convince themselves why what they're doing, which is really grand theft, why is it good? Why is it a positive thing? And so usually it's religion or science or a pseudoscience that justifies it.
All right, thank you for that question. And then Taylor's going to ask
you. Okay. What factors do you think promoted territorial expansion?
I think it goes back to your justification. I think there's a lot of economic factors behind it. People want farms.
Mm-hmm.
People want
money. Yeah.
Yeah, they want more money. They if there's gold out there, you have gold rushes, mm-hmm. you have silver rushes, and then you have. For example, in the American West, railways were given huge land grants if they would go out and build the railroads out there. Well, an acre of territory in the middle of, let's say, Nebraska or Wyoming, isn't that valuable if you can't get the goods off that territory to a sellable market. In other words, you can have the best wheat field in the world, but if you can't get that wheat crop to market, what good does it do you? You're just going to sit around and eat wheat checks all day long. It doesn't help you. So what the railroads realized very early is we have to have farmers to give value to the land. But the railway then gave value to the land to the farmers. It's a symbiotic relationship. The farmers need the railroad needs the farmers. And so, the railroads would go over to Europe and say to somebody in Germany, you want a farm in Minnesota, you want a farm in Wyoming, a ranch, then we'll come out here. And for the European, this is a great deal. Where else am I going to get a farm? So I think there's a lot of economic motivation behind all of it. And ultimately, lot of the West gets developed by big businesses. Some of the biggest, today you don't have a lot of small family farms. They've given away to basically corporate farms. And you see the same thing with mining. You know, people might have gone out west because they're going to get their tin pan and sit by a stream and make a fortune in gold. But in reality, very few people made a lot of money that way. When mining really pays off is when you get a corporation with millions of dollars backing it, and then they go out there and they buy up the rights and they basically tear down a mountain to get at the silver inside the mountain.
So I was saying, also watch various election cycles. For example, when Pope runs for president, it's 54-45, we want the Oregon Territory, we want California. So politics would be a motivation. But I would think probably the driving force behind it is the economic data that we have. And I think all the others are major factors. You just have to, and it probably varies from individual, you know, to individual. The Mormons go out west seeking to set up a religious utopia. So I think, you know, religion is a key component of their decision. Then, as I mentioned earlier, you have people in the coming of the Mexican War wanting to go out for to extend their culture to have slave territory, to have free territory. Political advantage, what's popular with people when you're running for president, but underlying it all, I think, you know, when you look at the individual man and woman who's deciding to go west, whether it's, you know, California for the gold rush or to get a farm in Kansas or whatever, I think it's an economic motivation.
All right.
Thank you so much. That's all we need.
That's it.
We interviewed the other people in our group to see what they thought of the four essential questions that our teacher assigned to us.
How has territorial expansion been justified?
Territorial expansion has been justified by a thing called manifest destiny. Manifest destiny is when the Americans thought that it was a God-given right to expand from coast to expand America from coast to coast.
According to them, it was part of God's plan to spread our culture all across the land. Our democracy was simply the best, so it's only right that we take the Southwest. Others spoke up, so let's take it slow. We need to respect the rights of Mexico. But James K. Polk took the reins. War broke out and more land was gained.
They also thought that the Indians were savages, so there really wasn't a, like, it didn't matter if they took their land. And they thought that there'd be more minerals and riches on the other side, so they thought that it would be okay. Like, they took advantage of that land. What do you think?
I think that they just thought they had the right to the land. And so they already thought that they had things on it that they needed and wanted. They did it out of, like, greed, because they thought somebody else was going to get it if they didn't. They thought they just had the right to it because they were them.
What factors promote territorial expansion?
Okay, something that promoted territorial expansion was adventure. And adventure caused people to get excited about seeing the new world. And instead of staying in the same place, they also wanted, like, gold because they wanted to improve their wealth. Example of that is the California gold rush, as thousands of people went over there just to find gold, but they didn't succeed.
Yeah, like Brian said, for the gold, yeah, it would make them a lot richer and maybe be able to trade with lands better.
We sat down with Patrick Collier, a history teacher at the middle school, to discuss two of the essential questions our teacher assigned to us.
Okay. What responsibilities does America have towards the inhabitants of a newly acquired land?
I think it is our responsibility, if we were to go acquire land, would be to treat the inhabitants just like we treat our own citizens. Not necessarily force them to be American citizens. But keep their own religious beliefs, their own, you know, style of government in a way that is not completely contradicting ours. But you know, allow them to keep going through their life the same. But give them, at the same time, give them the chance to be a member of the system. You see that in some occupancies like Puerto Rico, they have the chance to be a member of the system if they choose to, but we don't force it upon them. So I think with us going out and applying for that, you don't totally change the way of their lives. You show them ways that it might make it better if they need to improve it, but you treat them equally.
What has been the impact of American expansion on the inhabitants of the acquired territory?
It really depends on what you're looking at.
From an
Indian perspective? Okay. That, I think, has been handled pretty, they kind of went at the bad end of the deal, I guess you could say. We need all that to Andrew Jackson and the removal act and see that right away, and then we were trying to almost force them away from us just because we needed more farmland. Or, in Georgia, we had a gold rush, and we wanted that gold, which was on a new territory. And so we moved them away from what they were known, and gave the land to Native Americans was very important. They had many religious and personal, almost, beliefs in the land around them, and they believe that it was there and been handed up generation for us to force them out of it, into Oklahoma or up in that area. Reservation is detrimental, I think. So I think Native Americans have had it pretty rough. I mean, and they've tried to withstand through fighting, especially when we started expanding westward, when we got out to, through the Yarborough River Valley. Ever since day one, they've been trying to fight us for that, and each time it's a big loss for them. So I think that's been a huge effect, not only on the society of all Native Americans, but individuals as well, who've had to go through everything, who lost it all. They were forced to move thousands of miles away. Away from what they know in their lives and what their parents lived on and what their grandparents lived on. It's been a big hit.
What do you think America would have done if they improved that situation?
I think we could have done basically what we do, kind of what we do now, if we acquire a territory. Kind of let them be on their own, kind of work out treaties, which we did. A lot of them failed, but you have to have almost a complete understanding of throughout everyone being on the same page, everyone on the same level, an agreement to really make sure that they were able to treat you like citizens. They're not second class. But at that time, I feel like it was more difficult because people weren't the land. I think if we kind of, like I said, attacked it that we do these days, and really kind of help them out, it would be a complete change. Maybe a little, maybe it would happen a little different.
What responsibility does America have towards the inhabitants of a newly acquired territory?
Well, when it comes to people who already live in the place that you want to live in, you should show respect to them because they've been there, longer than you. Even if you do, feel a need to live there, you should sort of work around where they are and, not try to force them out of what they've been living in for years and years because it's sort of unfair. And I feel like if you're going to barge in to live where someone's been living, you should really be careful about how you do that, unlike how we did.
Yeah, you should kind of, as he says, show respect, because we should have been nicer to them. We could have traded with them, become good friends with them. We could have helped them a whole bunch, and they could have helped us if we had just not barged in all evilly or anything.
What has been the impact of American expansion on the inhabitants of acquired territory?
I'll go first on this. So when the Native Americans were pushed off their lands, they were sent to camps and other places, and many of them died of disease and just
being killed.
Yeah, being killed by the English.
What will happen to us? Your father died last night, they tell me. My mother and my father's clan members are crying. It just doesn't seem real. Nothing seems real. We are led out of the stockade. The guards all have guns and are watching us closely. We walk. My mother keeps me close to her. I wish I had a blanket. But the mountains are behind us. Each day, we start walking a little later. They bury the dead in shallow graves because the ground is frozen. As we walk past white towns, the whites come out to watch us pass. No words are spoken to them. No words are said to us. Still, I wish they could stop staring. They made me leave our homes. They made us walk to this new place that we are heading in the middle of winter. I don't like these people. When I went to sleep last night, my mother was hot and coughing worse than usual. When I woke up, she was cold. I tried to wake her up, but she just lay there. My uncle pulls me from her. My aunt begins to wail. My mother's death, I do not understand. But I suddenly know that I am alone. I want to cry. I want to scream in rage. I can do nothing. The soldiers make us continue to walk. I walk. In loneliness, I know what it is to hate. I hate the people who killed my father and mother. All they ever saw was the color of our skin. All I see is the color of theirs, and I hate them.
And so their population went down by a lot.
Yeah, because they all died. And on the Trail of Tears, a bunch of Cherokee Indians died from disease and being pushed off the land.
So they were, as I said just a minute ago, they were pushed onto their land, this area of land that was made out for them so they could stay on there. It was just, they experienced some really harsh conditions.
They really did.
I'm Nick Powell, and that concludes our documentary about land expansion west of the Mississippi River.
They also thought it had good resources. Good resources, and that it might have gold and other cool things, everything.
I'm sorry.
Brian!
Brian's first.
Okay.
I think they.
Okay.
And they.
Indians, Native Americans, as we say, they
start over. It has been very...